Lucy Letby, serial killer. Why did she kill? Part 16. Hello. We now continue with an analysis of the judge's sentencing remarks to gather further insight into the mind and behaviours of Lucy Letby. The judge continued as follows. The impact of your crimes has been immense, as disclosed by the deeply moving personal statements that have been read to the court this morning. Naturally, the impact of murdering newborn children probably would rank amongst the most awful and heinous behaviours that many people could imagine. With that, the revulsion, the responses, the grief that comes would provide a tsunami of fuel. Or was there something else that was sought? Was it revenge? Was it simple, a need for entertainment, a need to feel powerful? Whatever it was, Lucy Letby's behaviour of murdering children enabled her to go very much in at the deep end, whether it's with regard to the pursuit of fuel, the pursuit of feeling powerful, in terms of showing potentially sadistic behaviours. The lives of newborn or relatively newborn babies were ended almost as soon as they began, and lifelong harm has been caused, all in horrific circumstances. Loving parents have been robbed of their cherished children, and others have to live with the physical and mental consequences of your actions. Siblings have been deprived of brothers and sisters. You have caused deep psychological trauma, brought enduring grief and feelings of guilt, caused strains in relationships and disruption to the lives of all the families of all your victims. Plainly, an individual with no emotional empathy would not be concerned by any of those consequences. Indeed, it may well be the case that in causing such chaos, such far-reaching consequences, an individual would revel in their activities. It is no part of my function to reach conclusions as to the underlying reasons or reasons for your actions, nor could I, for they are known only to you. I must pass appropriate sentences according to law, addressing the seriousness of your offences, the facts of which I now describe briefly. On the evening of the 8th of June 2015, you murdered A. He died just over 24 hours after he was born, suddenly and unexpectedly collapsing shortly after you took over as his designated nurse at the start of the evening shift. He was in a nursery with his twin sister, B. Although he was born prematurely, he had been extremely stable. He died of an air embolus as a result of you administering a bolus of air into his venous system, which blocked off the blood supply to his heart and lungs. In common with all nurses, you knew from your training the dangers caused by air getting into the venous system, and that air embolus were very rarely encountered in clinical practice. You took part in the attempts to resuscitate A. Might this be indicative of her seeing herself as some kind of angel, acting as both fire starter and fire man, causing the problem to then save that person as a consequence of what she has done? And claimed you found the process of taking his footprints and handprints, as well as photographs of him after his death, to be quite a nice thing to do for the baby, and you saw it as a way of giving parents memories. In evidence, you sought to blame others for his collapse. The following day, you searched for A's mother on Facebook, and then on the ensuing night shift, at shortly after midnight on the 10th of June, you attempted to murder his sister B by injecting air into her venous system via a long line through which she was receiving nutrition. Fortunately, she was able to be resuscitated and survived. 4 days after B's collapse, in the early hours of the 14th of June, C collapsed and died in the intensive care nursery. He had been born 4 days earlier, at 30 weeks gestation in good condition, but was vulnerable. He had a lung infection which was being treated by antibiotics. However, his breathing stabilised. He was being fed by a nasogastric tube. You messaged a colleague saying you needed to throw yourself back in and take an ITU baby soon. Is this the insatiable craving for fuel that's driving her to behave this way, or that nagging itch to exercise power over people? On that night shift of 13th, 14th of June, you were designated nurse for two babies in another nursery. C was started on trophic, that is tiny, feeds that night. You were at the side of his incubator when he stopped breathing, and his oxygen saturations were very low as a result of you having deliberately infused an excessive amount of air down his nasogastric tube. Attempts to resuscitate C failed, and he died some hours later in his parents' arms. Before he passed away, you made an insensitive and inappropriate but revealing comment to them about them having said their goodbyes and to put him in a ventilated basket. Understandably, they reacted to this. This again is demonstrative of an absence of emotional empathy and also shows a disconnect with the surrounds, which again supports the individual more likely to be a narcissist or psychopath. Just over a week later, in the early hours of Monday 22nd of June, D, who had been born 36 hours earlier, died in the intensive care nursery. You will have been aware that she was being treated for an infection and were the designated nurse for two other babies in that nursery on that night shift. You decided to kill her and administered air into her intravenously, causing her to die from air embolus. You were involved in her resuscitation, again, fire starter and fire snuffer. And in your messaging with other nurses after Dee's death, you described how upsetting it was and how distraught her parents were, and referred to thinking an element of fate was involved. Is this the flexing of godlike powers to talk about fate? 3 days after Dee died, you searched for her parents on Facebook, and over 3 months later, on the 3rd of October, you made two more searches for her father. Over a month passed before you killed another baby. Again, it was a twin who was selected, E. He and his brother F were born on 29th of July. E died in the early hours of the 4th of August. During the shift that night, you were the designated nurse for both E and F. E died of air embolus, and there was damage to his upper gastrointestinal tract caused by trauma of some kind inflicted by you, which resulted in significant blood loss. The bleeding started earlier in the shift and was seen by his mother. She was very concerned, and you sought to reassure her. The circumstances of the attempted resuscitation and his death were harrowing, with profuse bleeding. At the time, the clinicians thought he may have died of necrotizing enterocolitis, and no post-mortem was undertaken. You commented in messages to colleagues that he had a massive hemorrhage and it could have happened to anyone. Is that a flippancy and dismissiveness, the haughty and curled arrogance coming to the surface? On the following night shift, the 4th, 5th August, you turned your attention to F and poisoned him by adding manufactured insulin to his intravenous infusions of total parenteral feed. Only very small volumes of insulin needed to be added to the half-litre bags of feed. It was not noticeable in the bag, nor would it be apparent that any was missing from the insulin bottle. You infused a bag that was hung that shift and several other stock bags. As a result, when bags were changed, F continued to have dangerously low blood sugar levels despite increasing infusions of dextrose. It was only when a bag that had not had insulin added was hung that his levels recovered and he was no longer at risk of the consequences of hypoglycemia, of brain damage and potential death. F recovered but has severe learning difficulties. No doubt you were reassured that no one suspected that insulin had been added, and with this knowledge you went on to repeat this method of attempting to kill another twin, I, some 8 months later. Again, you made Facebook searches. On the 6th of August and the 14th of September, you searched for his mother and you searched for both parents in October. In September, you made two attempts to kill G. She was a very premature baby who was born in Arrow Park Hospital on the 31st of May at only 23 weeks and 6 days gestation. Although on the margin of survival, she did survive. By 13th of August, she was stable and was transferred to the Countess of Chester, where the general trend of improvement continued. The 7th of September was a 100th day of life. Nurses had planned a small celebration, including the display of a banner. On the night shift of the 6th and 7th, you deliberately injected milk and air into G's stomach down the nasogastric tube, shortly after her designated nurse had fed her, causing her to projectile vomit. Her alarms sounded, her heart rate and saturation levels dropped, and she required breathing assistance. You were nearby and assisted. Again, fire starter and fire snuffer. And you later sought to blame a colleague for potential overfeeding. In messaging prior to G being transferred back to Arrow Park in the early hours of the 8th of September, you referred to her being a high-risk baby. 5 days after G's return to the Countess of Chester, on the 16th of September, you made a further attempt to kill her, on 21st of September, by overfeeding her, causing her to projectile vomit again and stop breathing, and her saturations to drop. G suffered a severe and profound injury to her brain from the first event on 7th of September, which may have been added to by your actions on 21st of September, and from which she will not recover. She requires constant nursing care and attention, and will require surgery and support throughout her life. Just over a month later, you murdered H. She had been born at Arrow Park Hospital on 7th of August and had been at the Countess of Chester from 18th of August, apart from two short periods in September and October. When at the Countess of Chester, she suffered a series of sudden, unexpected and unexplained episodes. On the 30th of September, you infused a large quantity of air down her nasogastric tube into her stomach and bowel, therefore interfering with her breathing, reducing her oxygen saturations and heart rate, and causing her to vomit and require oxygen under pressure. It is also likely that, in the early hours of the 13th of October, you infused air into her venous system. The following night, she collapsed again, but recovered with breathing support and was transferred to Oro Park for 2 days. 6 days after her return, on the night of 22nd, 23rd of October, she suffered her final collapse, crying out in severe pain as a result of air ambulance after you had injected air into her venous system. She too died in her parents' arms. Not only was it devastating for H's family, it was also deeply upsetting for the nursing and medical staff who had known and cared for H for some time and had fought to save her. Again, this level of upset, does this provide accentuated fuel responses for Letby? Or is this more linked to the fact of she delights in seeing people fight against the wielding of her power, albeit unsuccessfully, making her feel all the more powerful. In early April 2016, you administered insulin to I and injected air into the venous system of his twin brother J, repeating what you had done 8 months earlier to the twins E and F. They had been born on the 8th of April. You added insulin to the dextrose bag that was set up for I within 2 hours of his birth, and to several other bags that were later hung. On 9th of April, when I was hypoglycemic, you injected air into J's venous system, causing him to suffer a profound apneic episode and cardiorespiratory arrest. It took just under 30 minutes to resuscitate him. You were present throughout. A piece of paper towel on which details of the drug administration notes had been noted during the emergency and a blood gas printout which you had retrieved from the confidential waste were found at your home after your arrest, and you also took home handover sheets relating to Jay. See earlier observations about the acquisition of these materials. You made a note of the event in your diary. Jay suffered irreversible brain damage as a result of his cardiorespiratory collapse, and over time, he may well deviate from his peers in relation to attainment and cognitive or motor function. On the 3rd of June, you attempted to murder Kay. He had been born on 2nd of June. His mother is haemophiliac. This interested you. When his designated nurse went on a break in the early hours of the night, after he was born, you inflicted some painful trauma to him, causing him to scream, bleed, and profoundly desaturate. Fortunately, he survived, but he could have suffered the consequences of the trauma to his throat. Almost a week later, on the 21st of June 2016, XY gave birth to identical triplet boys. Although on holiday at the time, you were communicating with colleagues about the triplets and said you felt most at home in the intensive care nursery. Is this an individual exhibiting care and emotional empathy by taking an interest in a job whilst away? Or is it a morbid fascination which relates to the extension of power and alternatively the provocation of responses to draw fuel? On your first day back at work on the 23rd of June, you were the designated nurse for L and M, who together with their brother O were all in the intensive care nursery. That afternoon, Elle suffered a series of sudden and unexpected collapses as a result of you administering air down his nasogastric tube, as well as into his venous system, and you inflicted trauma to his liver, causing significant bleeding. The horror of the consequences of your actions and the desperate attempts to resuscitate him and save his life, sadly to no avail, were vividly described by clinicians and his father. The following day, you murdered his older brother, M. You forced air down his nasogastric tube into his stomach and bowel and inflicted trauma to his liver, but not damaging it as severely as you had in L's case. The air caused his diaphragm to splint and he collapsed. His life could not be saved. His father remembered him struggling for his life like his brother. O was removed to another hospital and to safety. In messages to a friend and colleague when investigations into the unexpected collapses and deaths on consecutive days were underway, you referred to the risk of air embolus and your having submitted a Datix report, which you did in a totally unrelated case on the 1st of July, referring to one of lumens through which intravenous medication was being administered via an umbilical venous catheter being open. The cruelty and calculation of your actions were truly horrific. Again, is the judge accurate to describe it as calculated? It's certainly cruel, and would fit with sadism, perhaps. After these last collapses and deaths, you were suspended from nursing duties but pursued complaints of being treated unfairly. Victim mentality. When your home was later searched, as well as your 2016 diary, which contained references to long days on 23rd, 24th and 25th of June, and to L and M, there were handover sheets over that period with resuscitation notes written on the back. All, I have no doubt, being records that you kept to remind you of the details of the consequences of what you had done to those children. Is this the gathering of trophies by this individual? Is this being done for the purposes of reveling in her supposed power over these weak and vulnerable individuals? Alternatively, is this the removal of information because she wished to nullify potential threats to control by keeping this information? For the offence of murder, the sentence is fixed by law and is imprisonment for life. You are now 33 years of age, and you were over 21 when you committed the offences. Pursuant to the relevant prevailing statutory regime, by having regard to Schedule 21 to the Criminal Justice Act 2003, I have to determine whether the seriousness of the offences of murder, individually or in combination, is so exceptionally high that I should not make a minimum term order, and you should spend the rest of your life in prison. For offences of attempted murder, whole life sentences of imprisonment are reserved for wholly exceptional cases. Over a period of just under 13 months, you killed 7 fragile babies and attempted to kill 6 others. Some of your victims were only a day or a few days old. All were extremely vulnerable. They were in a hospital where others were striving to provide them with dedicated medical and nursing care. By their nature and number, such murders and attempted murders by a neonatal nurse entrusted to care for them are offences of very exceptional seriousness. The damaging impact of your actions on others working at that hospital, including those who numbered you as a friend, betraying their trust and creating upset and suspicion, as well as eroding confidence in clinicians and nurses generally, aggravates their seriousness. This was a cruel, calculated, and cynical campaign of child murder, involving the smallest and most vulnerable of children. Knowing that your actions were causing significant physical suffering and would cause untold mental suffering. Is this the case that this was a premeditated campaign where she just wanted to do it again and again? Or was this of the moment where in aggregate it is appearance of a campaign, but she was simply reacting to threats of control as and when they arrived, in the most serious and dangerous manner that can be conceived? You created situations so that collapses or causes of collapses would not be obvious or associated with you. Covert behaviour. You removed and retained confidential records. Sense of entitlement, lack of boundary recognition, lack of accountability. Of events relating to your crimes and checked up on bereaved parents. There was a deep malevolence bordering on sadism in your actions. During the course of this trial, you have coldly denied any responsibility for your wrongdoing and sought to attribute some fault to others. You have shown no remorse, There are no mitigating factors. In their totality, the offences of murder and attempted murder were of exceptionally high seriousness, and just punishment, according to law, requires a whole life order. Lucy Letby, on each of the 7 offences of murder and the 7 offences of attempted murder, I sentence you to imprisonment for life. Because the seriousness of your offences is exceptionally high, I direct that the early release provisions do not apply. The order of the court, therefore, is a whole life order on each and every offence, and you will spend the rest of your life in prison. Those are the sentencing remarks of the judge, which again provide us with an opportunity to understand more about her mindset and behaviours, and the way also that they have been viewed. In the next part, we are going to bring together the strands and then look at the determination as to what Lucy Letby is.